And we're back, family, on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. We've got Dr. Tommy J. Curry. Where did Dr. Tommy J. Curry go? We just lost him, but he'll be back. I was just talking to him in the green room. And so today's show is going to be about racial battle fatigue, black misandry. But we're also going to have a conversation about R. Kelly, what's going on with that situation, and our thoughts on that. And Dr. Tommy Curry has a new book called Another White Man's Burden, Josiah Royce's Quest for a Philosophy of White Racial Empire. And so we'll wait for Dr. William A. Smith to come back, and we will welcome Dr. Tommy J. Curry. How are you, my brother?
I'm doing well, sir. How are you?
I am good. Well, we've got a lot to talk about, always.
Absolutely.
It's never something like, oh, I ain't got nothing to say. I really didn't have to, you know, everything is just perfect in the black world. So the big elephant in the room right now is the situation with R. Kelly. I saw you put a post on your Facebook saying, look, if we don't deal with black boys being raped, don't be surprised when they grow up and you see black men with 15 and 16 year olds.
Right.
Talk to us about that and how you feel about that. How do you feel about the R. Kelly situation?
Well, I think R. Kelly's a complicated situation, given that he's also a victim of abuse, you know, at the hands of his sister, Teresa. You know, what disturbs me about R. Kelly is that there's this move after the docuseries and throughout popular media to again put black men in the position of being society's worst sexual predator. We're not understanding R. Kelly as an individual. What we're saying is by analyzing or by considering the experiences of black women and girls, that we have to understand that black men are predators. But that's not the whole story. And when you look at sexual violence in our communities, yes, some black men are sexual predators. Many black women are sexual predators, not only against young black boys, but also young girls. And always the elephant in the room that we never want to talk about is same-sex predation with black men and other black boys. Oh. So our community is just like every other community in the country and in the world. You have sexual predators that are not defined primarily or solely based on one sex and gender. But that's not the conversation that's going on right now. And look, it's not the case that every child that's sexually abused becomes a sexual predator. You know, I'm always very careful to make that distinction, both in the literature and just in terms of common sense. But it is a possible pathway that if you do abuse a child, right, or sexually violate or rape a young boy or a young girl, there are consequences to that. Uh-huh. Some of it's depression. Some of it's withdrawal and social isolation. Some of it's promiscuity. Some of it's a child before the age of 21. Some of it risky sexual behavior, right? You know, we've talked about this before. All these are possible outcomes. R. Kelly just manifests one of those outcomes. And that doesn't mean that we're defending R. Kelly or I'm defending R. Kelly. But to say that R. Kelly is an archetype of black men and due to toxic masculinity is the most erroneous and dishonest account and description of R. Kelly's pathology that I've seen. You know, and the frustration is that we don't have psychologists. We don't have social workers. We don't have people that work with victims of sexual molestation weighing in. What we have is every entertainer from, you know, Touré to John Legend, giving their opinion about R. Kelly and creating a social movement that's trying to get him convicted. And I have no problem if the statute of limitations are not up, if these victims are telling the truth and a court will hear their case, go for it. Have at it. Bring the man to justice. But that has nothing, that has absolutely nothing to do with black men writ large. The same way that when I give accounts after accounts of black women who kill black men, of black women who rape little boys, that does not have anything to do with black women writ large. It has to do with the specific communities, the circumstances of poverty, the assumptions about black male hypersexuality, and the lack of accountability or conviction of women or female sexual predators. And we don't have that kind of nuance right now. So the conversation about R. Kelly is very much a dishonest one and is being framed with the idea of the black male predator and the black male rapist rather than any kind of nuance or compassionate view, both for the victims who certainly need mental health services and who need help, and R. Kelly, who needs to get treatment and rehabilitation so that he doesn't go out and abuse more children.
Do you see once again that when one black person in the media does something, it's all black people.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Like every one of us are guilty. Everyone's walking around looking, you know, cross-eyed, you know, so we had the Bill Cosby situation.
Absolutely.
We had the Kevin Hart situation. Yes. And the list goes on and on.
Well, now the R. Kelly, now they're making a piece about Michael Jackson.
Right. Now they're making a piece about, right. Right. So they're, you know, they're bringing that back up again. So what is, you know, obviously it is some level, deep level of institutionalized racism in this media.
Absolutely.
That is propagating this and setting this up and trying to destroy the positive image of black men, regardless of their talent.
Regardless of it. And this is, you know, Michael Jackson was clear. You know, this is what upsets me. Michael Jackson was accused by a litany of children, no convictions. Several of the people who accused him came out and said that they lied about it. They were put up by their family. One person that accused him fell into deep depression, committed suicide. Right. It was never held to be true. You know, the same thing with the Nate Parker situation. The man went through trial after trial, was acquitted by an all-white jury and one black woman. And then a decade or two decades later, still people say, well, he's a rapist. Uh-huh. There is no barometer or gauge of innocence for black men in this country. And that's not to excuse black men who are guilty of sexual crimes. That's to say that anytime you accuse a black man, if he's innocent or not, think about the situation with Brian Banks, who was accused by a black woman, you're going to lose your career. Uh-huh. So there is no, I write about this in The Man Not, there is no character. There is no actual law or legal standing that will protect black men from society stereotypes about them. Regardless, and Brian Banks didn't even do anything. Uh-huh. Didn't even do it. And the woman did it for money. So we have to look at the vulnerability of black men generally, and then look at that on a case-by-case basis with accusations of rape and sexual assault. Because again, when you look at the data, it does not show that black men are overwhelmingly the single or sole perpetrators of sexual violence in our communities. It shows enormous rates of being made to penetrate, where over 70% of those perpetrators are made to penetrate cases are women. You see the same thing in terms of sexual manipulation and coercion and statutory rape. You see the same thing in early sexual debut. They over 40 to 70%, depending on the study, say that they're violated by women. So if that's true, then why are we having a conversation that's not looking at all sexual violence as if black male victims don't exist, as if the trauma caused by black male sexual victimization doesn't exist? R. Kelly certainly needs treatment. He needs to be held accountable. I haven't heard any black man say otherwise. But at the same time, I think that what's causing the issue is that there's no nuance to the conversation. Uh-huh. As you say, if one black person, specifically a black man, if one black man does it, every black man's guilty. Uh-huh. So if every black man's guilty and every, you know, the less than 1%, right? Because that's how that's less than 1% of the adult population gets convicted for rape. So even if you double that, right, or triple that, you're not going to get to numbers that could be representative of the adult black male population. So if something that's 1% or below becomes the basis of interpreting all black males in the country, then you're living and perpetuating a stereotype that you could never hope to prove nor address socially. And that's the problem, is that no one's really trying to address this. It's just accusation after accusation. And then it's hidden behind the idea, well, let's focus on black women and girls. Sure, let's focus on black women and girls and ask the question of how did he get access to these women? Uh-huh. How is it that these women, some of which are over 20 or 21 now, are choosing to live with them? Are there financial incentives? Are there cycles of abuse? Do these women, again, need mental help? Are they being put up by their families and parents, which I've heard some cases being? This is a communal problem where people are using sex and children for payoffs. And that doesn't come just from R. Kelly. It comes from all the enablers in the black community, both men and women, who allow R. Kelly to take advantage of these young women. But at the same time, nobody is speaking about these same black women, these same black communities that are allowing little boys who are 9, 10, 11, 12, 14 to have sex with much older women just because. Right. If we're not problematizing that, then what kind of social consciousness are we breeding in our communities to say that if a black boy lost his virginity at 9 and a black girl is having sex at 15 or 16, they're not going to object to that. Uh-huh. As grown men, they're like, well, I had sex when I was 9. right? And we found this in the studies as well, right? They recognize the abuse, but they don't recognize their own abuse. Uh-huh. So what's the moral outrage? Uh-huh. Uh-huh. You know, and this is something that I think really needs to be dealt with care. We need to have black people talking about actual sexual attitudes rather than trying to say that a black man's not falling in line with the popular media idea of lynch R. Kelly or ignore black male victims. So he must be in support of R. Kelly. That's the most ridiculous sentiment that I've ever heard. But it feeds a narrative, right? This is what the liberal media wants to do. It feeds a narrative that suggests to us that black men, because they're sexual predators, because they want to abuse women and children, are denying and not holding other sexual predators accountable. And I think nothing could be farther from the truth.
Well, you know, as you know, Dr. William A. Smith, who coined the term in the research, Racial Battle Fatigue, who introduced me to you, we've had extensive conversations on this. And I always say that we're not sick. We're sick from being around sick people.
Absolutely.
And so the question that I ask people in the R. Kelly situation, the Bill Cosby situation, or Kanye or Kevin Hart, whatever level or iteration you want to call, you want to place this. And I'm not considering Kevin Hart to be in the same category as a R. Kelly, but I'm saying this. When you were a little boy or a little girl, did you ever run up to your mother and father and say, "Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I want to be a pedophile. Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I can't wait to be the greatest drug dealer or drug addict. I can't wait to be strung out on crack cocaine. Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I want to intoxicate women, slip them a Mickey, and then rape them while they're passed out."
Right.
What happens to the black baby and the black boy from the cradle to their during their childhood to their teen years to adulthood that causes them to act in a maladaptive way from the stress of the racial stress that is constantly the micro and the macro aggressions from the time, and we also know now about epigenetics. You know, I've got Minicum coming on, and you know, he just sent me a study that was done that they now say the behaviors, characteristics, and traits can be traced back 14 generations.
Oh, fascinating.
So, yeah. So we know our historical trauma. When you look at someone, when I look at an R. Kelly, I first say, what happened to him? Mm-hmm. Because there were multiple things that happened to him. It wasn't just one trauma. It was multiple traumas on top of trauma. It was a cascade.
Absolutely.
As a black male, I don't get out of this alive. I don't get a reprieve. It's like, oh gosh, I'm going to go in this room here and it's going to be no microaggressions, no racism, no trauma, no stress. I never escape it. So what does that do to me mentally? And particularly, then I start to make a particular level of income that encloses me to Europeans, because at a certain number, all of the people who are handling my money and handling my life are European because of, again, institutionalized racism in our banking system and what have you. So what are your thoughts on that as it relates to the man not and as it relates to liberal media?
Well, I think you're absolutely right. The first question we have to ask is what happened, right? And you know, even the work of Dr. Carl Bell, he just published a book on fetal alcohol exposure. You know, saying that, look, you know, even when you look at poor black communities that are isolated, that don't have access to health care, you're looking at situations where sometimes women don't know they're pregnant. They're still drinking, and this has an effect on children, lack of impulse control, anger, violence, etc. There's so much that comes along with the conditions of oppression, poverty, neglect, observations of violence, lack of health care, lack of mental health diagnosis, right? That it becomes impossible to trace something down to a singular cause like black masculinity. And that's just on the basis of literature. The basis of academic literature gives you so many possible causalities for one behavior that it's intellectually irresponsible to suggest that it's only black masculinity and not trauma, not abuse, not beatings, not early sexual debut, not drugs, etc. So then we have to ask ourselves, why is the liberal media cultivating these kinds of images? Well, the liberal media is cultivating these types of images because the liberal media has a historical stake in making sure that black males remain demonized. Uh-huh. And this is the piece that always interests me. You know, when you look at studies that are coming from the internet, be it like Madame Noir or any of these black sites, The Root, etc., they constantly refer to the rate of abuse, right? So they'll say, look, given black people's population, you know, white people's numbers are 4 per 100,000 or 4%, and black people's numbers are 6.87, right? Uh-huh. And everybody runs with that rate. But what they don't understand is that because the population of black people in America is so much lower than that of white people, you may be talking about 500,000 victims of sexual abuse, or actually much less than that. I mean, it's closer to 300,000. And you may be talking to 1 million when you're talking about white people.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So and now think about that. Uh-huh. You can complain about rape all day, but in terms of the sheer numbers of victims and perpetrators, white people overwhelmingly constitute the majority of those.
Absolutely.
So that means that while the rate within a specific community may be higher, you're much more likely because of population to encounter, deal with, or be exposed or know an actual white predator, be they male or female.
Absolutely.
So then what's the stake that the media has in trying to represent black people as the face, specifically black men, as the face of sexual predation?
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Right? Because the numbers are so small. And the effect is intraracial, right? Because most people abuse, rape, et cetera, people that look like them. Then what does the white liberal media have? What interest do they have in cultivating this kind of alleged accountability?
Right. So as we move forward in this new population, because now the European is experiencing an irreversible birth dearth.
Yes.
And so by 2045, 2050, the majority will be, as they say, black and brown in this country and around the world. The numbers still don't add up.
No.
The numbers still don't add up. There are still more whites doing crime and perpetrating the same criminal acts and heinous acts. And what do you see possibly happening if there is going to be such a shift in the demographics of this country as it relates to the media?
Well, I mean, this is where it becomes difficult. I mean, majority populations don't give up power easily. They never have. You know, when the alt-right came after me, you know, taking some of the quotes out of my classes out of context, you know, one of my lecture about white America was that they're going to utilize violence to reassert the power they think they have by their demography. And this is what's crazy. You know, the democratic system is based on majority rule. Uh-huh. So when whites were the majority, they feel that, hey, we don't need to use violence and force, generally speaking, right? We don't have to use overt exhibitions of violence and force because we're the majority. So we can live under the pretense of the rule of law. But uh-huh. when the demographic changes shift, when black and brown people control government and constitute the majority of major cities and states with electoral college votes, then what excuse, what will you have to maintain power? And the answer to that is violence. So the reason we see the upsurge of violence around Trump is because it's a symbolic demonstration of what white people are in fact intent and capable of. Uh-huh. And again, this is the ignorance that we have. Everyone who is pessimistic about the era of race relations under Obama was called ideological.
Uh-huh.
Everyone who said Obama is not going to solve the race issue. Look at the decrease in black economic mobility. Look at the rise in black unemployment. Look at the increased visibility of police shootings. Look at the shift between the white moderate and the white conservative and what we now call the alt-right. Then what are we... What are we looking for? What are we trying to give an accountability to? And what you're seeing is trends that are used to try to reestablish power such that minority groups in the United States, in fact, accept that they're the minority. And that, again, people saying you won't replace us, people chanting it, people like Donald Trump trying to control immigration, given that America's white birth rates are down. These are all policies that have been pursued by every imperial nation that's been trying to keep its demographic representation up. Uh-huh. And in white republics, you see this, you saw the same thing with Britain. You saw the same thing with America at the turn of the century. racial diversity is a biological threat because it doesn't allow whites to maintain their alleged racial purity. So the same reason that you got Me Too as a response to white ethno-nationalism is the exertion of liberal feminist power to maintain their vulnerability against white men because they lost political representation. So notice how
Me Too. Not Me Too. I'm thinking of Black Lives Matter, because Black Lives Matter kind of have been really ineffective because they got
Completely ineffective. Yeah, absolutely.
So what happened there? You know,
but it's all reformism. It's listen. So if you think about it this way, if you want to maintain a republic and your republic has lower numbers, right? Who controls that? Who controls birth rates? White women. Uh-huh. And historically, and this is what I show in my research. Historically, white women have always used political gains to levy against white people's need to increase reproduction. They did it in the 1870s. They're doing it again. So Me Too is just the most visible movement that you have of white women again demonstrating what sexual harassment is and the rights to their body are, because the whole future of the white race depends on that.
Wow.
So this is what's interesting about it. But then Black Lives Matter is completely ineffective, because Black Lives Matter pursues an intersectional feminist account that holds black men to be the primary dangers in black communities. So you have 300 black men, 480 to 300 black men getting shot by cops a year. And it says, don't focus on the deaths of these black men. Focus on the deaths of trans, lesbian, and black women individuals. But here's the problem. Those numbers barely jump over 20 in any given year.
Uh-huh.
And those numbers don't comprise or compose the majority of prisoners in America's prison system. Those groups and numbers don't comprise or compose the demographic with the lowest life expectancy. So then you ask yourself, well, why is Black Lives Matter not worked? Because Black Lives Matter was never intended to work. Black Lives Matter was a distraction about the nature of patriarchy, which is, as you know from the Man Not, is designed to exterminate, demonize, and criminalize outgroup racialized men. So if Black Lives Matter makes the same kind of argument, which it does, because it's building off of the logic of intersectional invisibility, which was published in 2008 by Purdy Vons and Ibach, which says that, look, even though we know that patriarchy directly targets black men, even though we know that patriarchy is directly designed to directly oppress and eliminate racialized males, we need to focus on who gets the recognition, not the material effects of death. So Black Lives Matter builds off of a liberal ethos that is rooted on the dehumanization of black men, namely the premise that their deaths don't matter. So then what does Me Too do? Well, Me Too says hyper female vulnerability. Every woman's now vulnerable to even consensual sex. Well, who's the predators of the society? Black men. And we're in a moment with Donald Trump saying we need to keep racialized men of color out of the country. Uh-huh. So who's being shipped off? Mexican and black men. So everything in the society is criminalizing, designating, or condemning black men for their social existence, because the paranoia of the declining white demographics means that black and brown men are going to be the primary targets, because they're the ones impregnating women or created the threat of the white population decrease.
Well, yeah, and that goes all the way back to Dr. Francis Cresswell seems to talk about.
Exactly. And as you know, Sedanius's work in social dominance theory and supported male target hypothesis.
So again,
this is what I'm saying, is that this isn't just.
But here's another level of the hypocrisy. European women, by a ridiculous number, don't like their European men and date outside of their race, and choose other ethnicities, tall, dark, and handsome, because the European male is so restrictive and so difficult. They have moved to the other side, and the term is called autogenocide. Mm-hmm. They're literally killing themselves by. White women are between a rock and a hard place. They don't want their European male, but they do want men of color. But when they procreate with men of color, the white race begins to disappear and vanish.
Well, absolutely. But again, there is a core of white women who do marry white men consistently across generations. And I think that one of the things you saw even with the alt-right is that there are a core of white women that consider themselves alt-right that have dedicated themselves based on women's rights and racial heritage and legacy on marrying and continuing the white race. In some of these interviews of these women in the alt-right and some of the women on the conservative side, they've championed the idea of a racial genocide. They've suggested that a racial genocide is needed for the future of their children to exist. Wow. You've seen the same thing with liberal feminists.
Wow.
Right? Not championing genocide, but making the argument that any man who touches or approaches them, any man who makes any kind of advance to them is basically intending to rape them. And we saw this with the beginning of the Holla Back video where the white woman was walking up and down Harlem. These are deliberate constructions in the media that are trying to make black people and brown men, black and brown men, look as if they're rapists. Why? Because they're going to be criminalized. They're going to be perceived in such a way that they're going to either be killed, locked up, or completely ostracized from society. And think about it. When Weinstein got his case, Ashley Judd's case against Weinstein didn't go anywhere. The judge dismissed it recently, according to several news outlets. So how is it that R. Kelly, Bill Cosby, Michael Jackson, Nate Parker, people who've actually, I think R. Kelly was on trial back in the day. Mm-hmm. Clear the justice system, are being the poster boy of sexual violence and misconduct in American society,
uh-huh.
right? And white men who have had systematic accounts and charges put against them get off free. Like the white boy who had the video recorded himself raping someone,
uh-huh. Uh-huh.
right? He gets off free. So there is a very deliberate construction of black men as rapists. And again, it's not the consideration of black men as individuals. Is a consideration that one individual is in fact evidence of the disposition of the whole group.
Wow, fantastic. Well, welcome Dr. William A. Smith in the conversation. How are you, my good friend?
Oh, I'm well. How about you, brothers?
I am fantastic. We're obviously talking to, now you are responsible for me having a relationship with Dr. Tommy Curry. And I said, I got to get both of you guys on at the same time, just so that people know that there's two different people. Because nobody's ever seen the two of you together at the same time, right? I had to come correct and say, okay, look, people, no, they're not one and the same. They're really two different people.
So that's hilarious.
It could be dangerous.
It could be dangerous. That's right. That's right. So what we're talking about, Dr. Smith, is the elephant in the room we opened up with about the situation with R. Kelly. What I would like to talk to you about and bringing it into the conversation, as I mentioned to Dr. Curry, I made an analogy and said, okay, when you were a little boy or a little girl, did you ever go up to your mother and father or someone you held in, an adult you held in high esteem and said, Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I want to be a pedophile. Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I want to be a crack addict. I want to be a drug addict. I want to be a drug dealer. I want to be the best person to drug and rape women ever. No, it's never a goal. So how do we get here? And so my hypothesis in terms of all of this conversation research that I've been doing with all of you is that something has happened to us from birth to whatever age these maladaptive behaviors manifest. But now research also shows us in terms of genetic memory and epigenetics. I was telling Dr. Curry that Resmaa Menakem just sent me a report that behavior and characteristics and traits now can be traced back 14 generations. It used to be 3. So the proximity of being around and bombarded by whiteness kills us before we even have an opportunity to know who we are. And some of these maladaptive behaviors turn into the absolute worst, where of course we have our internal problems, but then they manifest externally, and you'll see someone like a Bill Cosby trying to navigate in an all-white society. You'll see an R. Kelly trying to navigate in an all-white society. And I'm not trying to blame all of this on white society, but I'm saying that it has to play some role in some part. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I definitely think it plays a role. And I think part of the problem is that our understanding of black males is from a dysfunctional orientation, mostly a pathological orientation. So oftentimes when there's behaviors that black men act out, we say that they're born that way. That's how they are. Uh-huh. Everybody else, almost every group gets the benefit of the doubt for some traumatic event occurring in their life that they'll say they are acting this way because of this episode or these episodes that occurred in their life. So they need some form of healing, some form of counseling, some form of treatment, some to be in a sweat lodge or something needs to occur. However, black men are demonic. Black men are violent. Black men, and you just fill in the blank, though that's what black men are. So they can't be healed. They're born that way. So if they're born problematic, then what? Why should we spend our time rehabilitating them when we know that there's no cure for them?
Wow.
But every other group, so if it's a black woman and she's traumatized because of some rape, and then she starts stealing, she goes start to use drugs, she beats her kids, they'll go back to those episodes to explain the behavior that she's doing currently. But that's not the case for black men. So, and I mentioned to you, and Dr. Curry knows this, my own father was raped by a woman. Now, he would be almost, actually, at this point, he would be over 80 years old now. Mm-hmm. All right. So just think about him from the age of 12 to 14, I believe it was, being raped by an older woman in her 20s. Mm-hmm. And once he told us that, now we should have known because of the age of his children, first child when he that he had, but and how young he was and how old the woman was. Uh-huh. But it explains so much about him and his inabilities to have relationships with the wives that he had, you know, throughout the course of his life, right? But when you don't account for those traumatic experiences and how they play out in someone's life, you just say, oh, he's just a dog, or he's just this and that, and it's always something negative. But when you're sensitive enough, if you love the black man enough, then you're able to start to ask different questions.
Yes, yes.
You just don't start from a pathological, dysfunctional orientation. And I think that's what you find. I don't even think this. I know that's what you find in Curry's work. Uh-huh. Curry asks those questions because he loves black men. He loves black people. So let's not get that twisted. Right. Some people start to think because he speaks up for black men that he has a problem with women in general or black women or something like that. Those are people who are on a very elementary level of understanding the trauma and the history that black people have experienced. What Curry is trying to do is to educate you so you can have more information to understand the trauma that black men have experienced that go unreported and then therefore discounted.
Absolutely.
Now, as you know, my family knows, my audience knows, you are the primary research and creator of racial battle fatigue. As you said on many occasions, as you were doing this research, you began to see yourself in the data. And that term really stuck with me. I now realize as I've done all of these shows, I see myself in the data of these shows and the conversation of these shows. Now, Dr. Curry, you have a new book called Another White Man's Burden, Jesiah Royce's Quest for a Philosophy of White Racial Empire. In there, you talk about the problem with assimilation.
Yes.
Which also speaks to racial battle fatigue and being in constant proximity to Europeans. Speak to us about assimilation from your perspective, and then Dr. Smith, I want you to come in and fill in the blanks on your side. Dr. Curry?
Yes, sir. I think it's important to understand that none of the theories that we have today in sociology or anthropology were pulled out of the air. Assimilation, as I argue in my text, was a theory introduced by environmentalists, which suggested that primitive peoples, they called them plastic races, races that could be bent and conformed in their contact with superior races like white Americans or Europeans, needed to assimilate the culture of the dominant and superior racial group. So at the turn of the century, there was this push for Anglo-Saxonism to be the dominant cultural frame that's used to civilize and imperialize the world. So what ends up happening from that is that they say, well, look, you have to make black people who are newly freed from slavery into white men. You have to make them think like white men. And if you don't do this, then America's empire is going to suffer the same fate of the British Empire. So Josiah Roy said, look, the reason the British Empire failed was because it let people keep their culture in their colonies. It created colonies and then let those people work and learn and speak still within their same language. And he said America could not afford that kind of result. America could not be so blind to the danger that cultural plurality and diversity has for building empire. So we have to assimilate them. We have to take away their culture. And the best way to do that for black people is to colonize them in the South. So we want them to be colonized like Jamaica. We want them to be poor. We want them to be ignorant. But we want them to look up to white people. We want them to look up to white men as the pinnacle of morality and culture. But in order to do that, we have to make them respect the law. So what do? We're going to create black people that police other black people. They'll have no authority over white people. They'll have no authority over white men, but they'll have authority over themselves. And then following Jamaica, you rape black women. So the black women have mulatto babies. And you educate these mulattoes as if they're part of America. You educate them in the mind frame of Europe and Britain, and you let those people control the savage black people in the southern states. And this debate, which was introduced by Royce at the turn of the century, was his answer to lynching and his answer to the myth of the black rapist. And if you want to solve this problem, if you want to keep your home safe, if you want to keep your white women pure, then you need to copy British administration instead of simply lynching black people. Because if you lynch black people, they get upset, they want to revolt. But if you take away their minds, well, they'll be passive animals that'll simply accept their social position in life. And I think that this isn't me in
Belgium. Well, yeah, this is written.
This is his actual quotes.
So, I think we should probably caveat that, you know, just to make a point for the family.
This is his actual quote.
This is in the book, family. This is written. This is research. It's an academic book.
but here's what's scary about that. Here's what's scary about it. Is that what we fail to understand, and this is what I'm constantly trying to point out with our analytics like gender and race, et cetera, is that they've largely been successful. That when you're talking about black Americans, when you're talking about the possibilities of liberation, when you're talking about the acknowledging of being oppressed, This is largely framed through the language of your oppressor. Right? No, your oppressor has I don't want to go back to the 19th century. I want to go to the 20th century, which is why I wrote the book. If you're talking about the 1900s, now I was born in 1979. Uh-huh. So 79 years before I was born, right? You're having debates about how you best colonize black people in the United States.
Wow.
So that means my grandparents were born in 1928 and 1930. So 10 years before they were born, this was the conversation happening in universities and academic conferences across the world in the United States and Britain. Wow. And I say that to put that in perspective.
Yes,
these historical times, right? These like Royce is having arguments with people in the 1920s and 30s about this. So the gap between how black people were thought simply to be people who were primitives and aliens and able to be colonized is not outside of our lifetime. We know people who were alive when these debates were happening. So if that's true, then what is it about the way that we think that makes us believe that we're somehow past that?
So if
this is the conference that's happening in 1930, 1940, around the First World War, this is happening around the Holocaust, what makes us believe that these ideas have not had some resonance, not only in the university, but in the thinking that we picked up on the basis of the Civil Rights Movement? Why did we not choose to revolt? Why did we not choose to be violent? Well, because the black bourgeoisie believed in assimilation. And you can see these debates in the 1960s between E. Franklin Frazier, W.E.B. Du Bois, Harold Cruz, et cetera. They're not making it up. They're talking in a language that says, look, the idea was that if we're going to join American society. We have to assimilate white culture. This is why Du Bois said integration is racial suicide. But you fast forward 50 or 60 years, and we think that we're so far removed that we accept the premises of Josiah Royce's program without question. And I'll give you a great example of that. The idea of building communities. Josiah Royce said that in order to make the foreigner and alien races feel welcome, you had to put them in their, you had to accept them in your communities, and you had to put them in your institutions, because it's through schools, churches, and local neighborhoods that they would forget their own racial heritage and their own racial legacy, and they would adopt the larger principles of a cosmopolitan society. So what's the first thing that Black Lives Matter does? It doesn't draw off of the militant civil rights tradition. It says, no, that's not us. Hands up, don't shoot. We're not violent. You don't notice. You don't even have a conversation about whether or not violence is or is not an expedient way to get political ends. You say you're just not violent. But then the police is still violent to the group, which is Black men that you claim that you're marching for. Oh, but then you go on The Breakfast Club, like Jamelia Lemieux and Amber Phillips, and say, yeah, they're killing them, but oh, but those people rape us anyway. You see, this is the contradiction. This is the same argument that Josiah Royce was having with Thomas Nelson Page, whether or not you should actually lynch Black men or just confine them away to some sector of society so they can't bother anyone. And we've adopted this same logic today. So assimilation is not just us acting like white people. It's about us thinking and rationalizing with the analytics and the ideas that white history and white cultures give us.
Dr. William Smith, William A. Smith, tell Tommy Curry to send you a book.
He knows it, and put your signature in there too.
That's right. That's right. Sign a copy and send it to Dr. Smith, please. That's just a doggone shame. You know better than that. Your mama raised you better, son.
I just got him in, people. Just got him in.
I'm just messing with you. Because we were joking about this earlier because I said, well, we're going to have this conversation about his book, but you know, pretty much we could have this conversation even though we don't have the book yet in our, in our physical hands. Assimilation, successful domestication, colonization, manifests by default racial battle fatigue.
Of course.
Speak to us about what. Speak to us about that, and piggyback off of what Dr. Curry just shared.
Well, I think it's pretty simple. It's a contradiction. So they might allow us to think that we're assimilated to a certain degree, that we have certain inalienable rights that are never held up. Mm-hmm. And it's that pivot that makes it more problematic for Black folks, because you're never fully a citizen, and you feel that. You feel that two-ness.
I do.
You're encouraged to assimilate. You're taught to assimilate through the educational structure and the workforce, that you have to become something like them in order to be successful. So you can't be organically who you are, right? But yet you never, we see with the glass ceiling for Black people, we see that you can't live in certain communities and
still go to Starbucks and just sit.
You can't go to Starbucks.
Go to a park and just barbecue.
Nothing.
Or, you know, grill. Yeah.
About 70% of those white women were calling the police on Black men, or a Black boy. So if over 70% of those calls, it's still a policing of the Black body, and you feel that. So you don't even have to feel it by your own experience, but I can feel it because I can see myself in a brother or a sister's experience. So Tommy can go through something in Texas A&M, and I know that I can go through that same thing here at the University of Utah, or I'm dealing with it currently. Uh-huh. So you never feel that you have a home fully, right? So if you don't have a home, you don't have a space, and then it's even more problematic because there are serving, like, for instance, the Native peoples in this country, they have sovereign rights, even though they're disrespected, right? But where does the Black woman and man go? Where, what land do we have? Now, we all say where our roots are is Africa. And we still don't know what nation to go to. Who has our back? So we're here oftentimes fighting a war without having our native land supporting us.
Wow.
Right? So you don't have that backup, which is it could be a psychological benefit to have somebody backing you up. But when you can't feel fully human, when you can't express yourself fully the way that you feel that you can and contribute the way that you can, all that leads to racial battle fatigue, because you know that your livelihood balances on this seesaw of somebody else's interpretation and attitudes towards you.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah. So yeah. You can say the right thing, but it's the wrong thing in white supremacist society, and you're gone.
Uh-huh.
Right? You can advocate, you could be a Colin Kaepernick. We got to control him.
Mm-hmm.
Just like J. Edgar Hoover said, we have to be careful of the rising of a black messiah. So we need to cut his head off at the first opportunity that we get.
Absolutely.
So when you try to speak up for your people, you're always at risk for being attacked, for being marginalized, from being ostracized, from losing your job, not getting pay raises.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, the work that I do, not even saying that it's equal to the work that you guys have done and are doing, but just the work that of doing this show, doing the research, that's it's a fatigue.
Yeah.
That I experience, because I'm trying to help my people, save my people, save myself, understand what's going on, find out, figure out what has happened to me. And you know how much energy that takes?
Huh. Oh, it's stressful.
Oh God, you know that. Oh, you shouldn't have so much cigars and scotch. I'm like, you. That's the only thing that's keeping you. You will hear about Sacramento if somebody don't get some scotch and cigars, doggone it. Wolf Blitzer will be right outside my damn door reporting live. I'm telling you that right now. So let's take a deeper dive into this, into your book, Dr. Curry. You talk about this is interesting. You say, what is racism, and how has this word been taken away from the specific history of slavery, Jim Crow, genocide, and white supremacy? What do you mean by that?
You know, and I think Dr. Smith, you know, when I ran across his work, it was a breath of fresh air.
I know that's right. Absolutely.
I mean, and this directly relates to the question. Most black academics think about racism as a kind of individual bias or a discursive obstacle that prevents them from getting the job they want.
Hmm.
Very few. And they call them radicals because they call them critical race theorists or systemic racist people, you know, race scholars, something like that. Very few people really look at racism as a structural and repetitive and reproducible outcome and disposition against black people.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Now that's important, because when you get into these conversations in high theory, philosophy, literature, lit crit, etc., racism becomes something that's based on wordplay. It becomes an idea where racism is a thought, it's a combination of sentences, it's a bias or disposition that one can manipulate through both language, speech, and the text. But that's not racism. That may be a part of racism, that may be a product of racism. But when you're talking about racism, you're talking about the disposition, and Derek Bell said this best, racism is the belief and the will, the anticipation that black people in America should not exist. So you're dealing with the disposition that a group of people have towards eliminating a whole sector of society. So what I mean by that in the book is, when you have debates with white scholars, they want to debate about attitudes. They want to debate about whether or not Josiah Royce actually liked black people. Right? That's the debate. And here's this is the insulting part about that debate. You're having this debate on the back of somebody that says that we should colonize black people like the British did to Jamaica. So the consequence, right? And this is what I mean. The consequence of that argument is that we're going to argue about whether or not a person that says that we should segregate blacks in the South, that we should only let them rule themselves, that they should be colonized like British people do in a colony, which is like the epitome of racism, in Jamaica, actually is a racist. Wow. And the effect of this, but this is what I'm saying. This is why Carter G. Woodson was doing something in the Miseducation of the Negro. The consequence of this is that black academics then entertain racism on that basis. That we need to debate, we need to discuss, we need to analyze whether or not we can tie an individual's personal beliefs to their scholarship. Whereas my book argues that if we know that racism is a means of demographic control, a process of death and dying, a technology of death and dying, then the debate we're having is whether or not a specific author, thinker, or philosophy actually has the effect of creating death and dying. So if Josiah Roy says we should not lynch you but colonize you so that you can't reproduce beyond the South, you fit the criteria of a racist.
Wow.
Vision a world where black people are not only inferior but should be controlled on the basis of that inferiority in social, political, or actual material, physical space. And the reason that that's important is because when you're looking at the racism that's happening to us today with Black Lives Matter and their alleged movement that's nothing more now than white philanthropists funding black people to market McDonald's who wear blue jackets, what you're looking at is the acceptance of the idea that certain black people, certain black groups deserve to die. Black Lives Matter hasn't stopped black male death. It argues about black men getting attention, but it hasn't stopped black male death. It hasn't demonstrated to the world that recognition or attention actually ameliorates the condition of death and dying. But in doing so, in ignoring black male's death, we know that the death and dying of black men and boys continues unabated throughout the society, throughout the country. Right? So that means that our understanding of racism has to change. It has to move beyond this notion of some kind of categorical identity. That we're just talking about the effects of white supremacy, which is how many intersectionality theorists think about racism. We have to get back to the idea that racism is very, very closely related to genocide. Because what you don't see, and I'll be very clear about this, what you do not see are Jewish scholars and genocide scholars making light of genocide as if it needs to be complicated beyond the fact that it kills people. So you have Jewish scholars that are arguing about rape, that are introducing rape, but the rape of women, of Jewish women, and the rape of Jewish men, as I've recently discovered, is ultimately rooted in, unshakably rooted in, the fact that they did not want Jewish people to exist. And that's unmistakable. That is not negotiable. But black people look at racism as if it's a condition that can be ameliorated if you live next to, marry, have sex with, or actually do what your oppressor tells you to do. So what is the difference in the trajectory of the scholarship? How do black people who are enslaved, go through Jim Crow, and now being exterminated by the state, have weaker theories of their own oppression and exploitation than Jewish scholars, right? Than other ethnic scholars, right? Who have actually assimilated to a certain degree and mobilized through the society. It's not because they're special. It's because they're dedicated to understanding the precise history of their people and the violence utilized against their people. Whereas black people are taught, right, through playing with words, through being incentivized to selling out certain sects of black people, that, hey, racism ultimately isn't that bad. Because you wouldn't want these niggas in the ghetto to have the same rights as you Negroes who are educated with degrees from Harvard. And that's been a very effective strategy because it's the Negroes educated at Harvard that have historically written about the niggas in the ghetto. And I think what our work is doing by reclaiming racism as this process and this technology of death and dying is showing that the relationship between intellectual discourse and theory is foundationally rooted in the disposability of poor black people, both men and women. And until we get that part right, until we're able to reconcile that part, that's why Josiah Royce's ideas seem so foreign. Because we don't have a notion of what a white man's burden is. We don't have a notion of what domestic colonization is. We just think it's oppression that stops us from getting jobs. We don't see how population control, how black people getting sicker, how black people dying earlier is part of a long game that's going to enable or not enable the white race to thrive in 20, 30, 40, 50 years. Which is the exact
by rendering us helpless, by rendering us ineffective, the white race is able to continue and white supremacy stays in place.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Now, you said something that triggered a previous conversation I had with you, Dr. William Smith, that when black men, when their income increases, so does their morbidity rate. In other words, that the more money you make, the more successful you are, the more you are forced, in a sense, to assimilate into European culture, and it kills you. Talk to us about that. Reiterate that for us, and connect that with what Dr. Curry just shared.
Yeah. Well, he said a lot of important things. So, what we do know is that education and income are not protective factors for black men. So, as much education as you can try to achieve, as much money as you can get in the bank, they do not protect you like they protect white women and white men in particular. So you are going to still have to deal with the fact that you are a black man who has a lot of money, or you are a black man with a terminal degree, and you're going to be treated like a black man who doesn't have one. So you're pretty much clustered in the same type of group where white folks will think of you just like they think about a brother in the hood. So you could have a PhD, and it's just like Malcolm said, what do they call a black man with a PhD? You know, he's still a nigga, right? And I believe Dr. Curry is definitely correct about this whole thing around genocide. So in my class this semester on racial battle fatigue, is a graduate course, the subtitle is We Charge Genocide, Racial Battle Fatigue and a Crime Against the Black Male. So what we're doing is we're looking at the Office of the UN Special Advisor on the Prevention of Genocide, and they have eight areas of their framework to try to help define whether genocide exists. So we're going to look at that framework, add to it to talk about the experience of the black man and genocide. If you don't look at it in that way, I believe you're doing a disservice to the experiences of black males in this society. We have to be real clear, real honest with ourselves. And I think I've said this on your show before. Do people really care about the black man? Do they really care about black people in general? If we were gone, if we took Derek Bell's space trader story, and it was real, would people be voting to have us taken to a different planet? You know, so there was a great book written by a sociologist that talked about the obsolescence of the Negro. Have we come to that point now where the Negro really is obsolete? Right? And if the Negro isn't, why is she and he being treated in such a way? Hyper-incarceration, sickness and death, as Dr. Curry has talked about. What is being brought into our community? Deserts, food deserts that are there. Poor education, poor transportation. It seems to me that we are basically on an island in many of these urban areas.
I will say this, and this smacks of Baldwin when he was talking about this in his work. Why do we need, you know, why do they need the Negro or the nigger? And my hypothesis, and I'm a biscuit and cornbread brother. I'm not, you know, I'm not a PhD brother, so I'm just going to keep it real. If you need a nigger or a Negro or whatever term you use so that you can feel some kind of way, you can feel superior, you can feel just and that you matter. If that's what you need, it means you weren't shit to begin with. If you are a bully and you need someone to beat up so you can feel good about yourself, you were a punk ass motherfucker to begin with. So let's just kind of keep that real, because in terms of that idea of the black man obsolete, being the fact that we are the majority, we're the original people on this planet, this society, this invasion, as Professor Kabahiawatha Kamani refers to them, this mutation of a mutation that came and created every war that we can imagine, now is dying off and dying out. Looking at Derek Bell's work and Dr. Curry, you had shared with me about the concept of racial permanence. It's not even a concept. It really is. Mm-hmm. That you really can't, you can't get out of white supremacy alive. In other words, that there you cannot assimilate into this. This is not something, family, that we can just make work. There has to be a line drawn. There has to be, it has to be dichotomous. And we have to redefine what is a black male, and do we need to start developing our own concept of black superiority or black supremacy to counterman and counteract the genetic, the epigenetic, psychological, axiological effects of this thing that we're in called racial battle fatigue?
Well, we have everything that we need at our hands. We have great thinkers. They don't have to have PhDs or work in.
Yeah, like you two. Yeah, we got great. Absolutely. You know,
we have people in our communities who are wiser than any professor at most prestigious institution. But we have to be real with ourselves and ask, you know, about this motivation towards genocide, or look at the extension of enslavement to a permanent underclass. And if we don't look at it that way, that why is it that this country wants black people as a permanent underclass, or let's get rid of them wholesale, then what we're doing is we're just trying to create some type of fantasy about we are all human, and that we, if we work hard and I do everything correct, that I can have a piece of this American dream that they sell to us. Uh-huh. And we know that that American dream is a nightmare for black people.
Uh-huh. Right?
And if we understand that, and if we turn to ourselves with the resources and intelligence that we have, we can create a society within it. We are a society within a society. Uh-huh. But what we have to be is independent of white thinking and white thought. And we can understand that what we possess and our deep culture is enough to get us out of this. But we have to believe in self. We have to believe in black people. We have to understand that there's also black plants in our community that are very disruptive. Mm-hmm. You know, we saw that coming out of the 60s with the FBI and their infiltration of movements there. And they had some black people who were plants, and they're still academic plants today. Mm-hmm. Who write things about us and say things about us, and then get paid handsomely. Uh-huh. To go around the country and talk about that, and particularly on black men being the worst thing that was ever created.
And that's so important, because when you look at the discussions about black men, I'll give you a really good example of this. I had a young scholar reach out to me on Facebook, friend me, and ask me, you know, to give feedback on his syllabus. And, you know, he posted his syllabus up. And the first question I asked is, why are there basically no black men on the syllabus? The syllabus is all, you know, bell hooks, you know, Kimberly Crenshaw, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know the spiel. There are authors on his syllabus that actually argue that black men are trash. People will hold this disposition. And my question to him was, why have you not tried to trouble any of this with the empiricism? Because when you look at the work of someone like a Wisdom Powell, when you look at the work of William A. Smith, when you look at my work, you know, you look at Staples' work, you know, the list goes on and on and on. You see people fundamentally challenging that, not just an idea, but with actual evidence. Uh-huh. The response to this was, he blocked me, right?
Basically,
I was like, I don't understand why you're using a deficit model here. So that tells you how dedicated and how much the kind of investment that black academics have into this narrative. Now, mind you, here's the important part. That narrative has no evidence. The people who substantiate that narrative, like people like bell hooks, have degrees in creative writing. They're not sociologists.
Oh.
Right? So it's not like sociologists are writing this, because in sociology, this would be considered racist, given that they're interacting with subculture violence theory. But in liberal arts, right? These non-empirical fields, you have people adopting subculture violence theory. You have people adopting cultural deficit model or you know, deficit model thinking, and nobody problematizes it because that's not the parameters and that's not the theories being utilized. So nobody knows, it's just the theory. And we all follow the identity politic. So black men are hyper-masculine, black men want patriarchy. So this is the natural consequence of that thinking. So this is what I'm saying. We know that the way that we're taught, right, going back to Woodson again, the way that black people are taught within white institutions have a primary and foundational effect on how black people think about other black people. The question we have to ask ourselves, and I think this is a question that Black Male Studies asks, and this is, of course, building off the work of Dr. Smith, is if you accept the reality of anti-black misandry, right, if you understand the hatred, the criminalization, the demonization and dehumanization of black men throughout history, then why is it that theories that make the same kind of argument today are considered liberal and progressive when historically they've been the poster child for what anti-black racism and white supremacy look like in America? The very same theories. Wow. So this tells us that there's something about the way that we're thinking, the way we're taught, and more importantly, how white liberals are incentivizing and investing in black scholars that are doing the kind of scholarship that says that black men are foundationally dangerous, condemnable, criminal, and need to be locked away and not see the daylight of society. So we have a real battle on our hands. And again, I think this is what's telling. Despite the issues that people have ideologically with the man not, there hasn't been a refutation of the man not. Because there are no facts that go the other way.
Right. Absolutely. Right?
There are no facts about.
Right. Well, truth recognizes itself. It's like, come on.
So you can be unhappy about the truth, right. but you can't pretend that there has not been a marriage between white supremacist ideas, feminism, and the idea of black male inferiority.
Right. Absolutely.
That's just the reality.
Last question. You talk about this in the work. You say you argue that many people appropriate Martin Luther King Jr. For their own purposes. So talk to me more about that and how that manifests itself in white academy.
Oh, well, I mean, that is the white academy.
He's the safe. I think it was you that said, you know, he's the safe black person, you know, in terms of, you know, when white people mention anything about racism, they automatically go to King versus Malcolm X. I have seen that categorically.
Absolutely. And again, this is what I mean about black people becoming caricatures.
But what I want you to define this time around is if you can define why. Why is Martin Luther King safe versus Malcolm X?
Because he doesn't want to extinguish white life.
Ah.
See, look, the white academy is not stupid. You know, George Jackson said this, you know. George Jackson said, look, you're never going to educate people out of their own power and privilege. the university, you know, and this is what makes me laugh about people in the university. They pretend they're so radical, but they won't. These are people who don't want to hurt flies. They don't want to eat a chicken leg because they hurt an animal. But they talk about they're against white supremacy, which has historically been built on revolutions and genocide. Right. These are not the people who are going to save us. OK. And what you end up what you have happen is Martin Luther King says we shouldn't violently revolt. Fanon is wrong. Right. Stokely Carmichael's wrong. These young people have the right idea by black power. There needs to be a somebodyness, an assertion of black humanity. But the way they're going about it is wrong because ultimately black power is about truth and justice. It's about justice doing the right thing, right? Doing the moral good. And that's what King is arguing against SNCC and against the people who are, you know, black power advocates. So what do white people do? White people pick the black person that's nonviolent and they bastardize his work. So you never see white people talking about King and white supremacy. You have white people talking about King, forgiveness, and segregation. Fit King into a motif that says, look, we're humans, we're brothers, right? So if we get along, if we're integrated and segregation is not keeping us apart, then everything else is just about understanding. But King isn't.
There's a passivity that they always appropriate with King.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And what happens in the case of these white supremacist authors like Josiah Royce had an idea of the beloved community, which was basically an Anglo-Saxon white supremacist community. And then King says, oh, you know, Royce's idea was good, but ultimately incomplete because he's a white supremacist. So white people say, hey, let's erase the white supremacist part. And let's say that King and Royce share a lineage together. And what do? They package that up, sell it to graduate students that do philosophy. So graduate students, because they're not taught to actually read, but only read what their professors give them, come out years later saying, hey, Josiah Royce, the guy who wants to eliminate black people, indigenous people, hates Chinese, hates Mexicans, right? This person is not racist because look, Martin Luther King and him got ideas from him. So he can't, would Martin Luther the King take ideas from a white supremacist? You would, and look at the kind of protection it gives them, because nobody wants to challenge Martin Luther King.
Right.
Martin Luther King is a great civil rights history, so a hero. So there's no reason that we would ever make a question beyond them asserting that Josiah Royce and King are in fact fundamentally related ideologically. And this is what goes on throughout the academy. We don't study W.B. Du Bois because W.B. Du Bois had great thinking about race and racism. We study W.B. Du Bois because white people say, hey, Du Bois studied with white people, so he's like the white people he studied with. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. There's not a figure in the academy today that has been introduced that has not overlapped with white figures. We don't study Fanon because of revolutionary violence. We study Fanon because of his existential humanism, which allegedly he got from Sartre. And this is the way that black academics are taught. So there's no independence of black ideas. King's arguments about anti-colonialism, his arguments about poverty, his arguments about imperialism, right? These things fade to the backside. They fade to the backdrop, because what is ultimately important about King is that a white theorist is like him. Uh-huh. And what that does to black thinkers, this is what's so important. What that does to black thinkers is it takes away the intellectual resources that the black scholar has to actually do revolutionary and liberatory work. So you could have a feminist say, hey, all men are rapists, all men are trash, all men are patriarchs, but you will not find a black race theorist make that argument about white people.
Wow.
So you can have white people. See, this is what I'm saying. You can have
What a great analogy. Wow.
That says that all the men in the world, Chinese, Japanese, indigenous, Mongoloid, pick a race, Hawaiian, Jamaican, every man in the world is patriarch and aims to oppress women. And that's never been the case. There has never been any system of oppression where all men, because of colonization, genocide, things of that sort, have had power over women. Because when white women come to colonies, white women have power over native men. When white women come to genocidal regimes, white women have power, or European women or German women have power over the racialized men that they're aiming to kill and exterminate. So it's never been the case historically that there's been a class of men that's unified themselves all against women. But throughout history, there have been cases where European powers, white Americans, white individuals, Germans, French, Portuguese, Dutch, Americans have all unified against African Asian. But we still won't call all those people who have unified fronts, who formed the League of Nations and the UN, as if they constitute groups and populations that are in fact all racist. Because if you say that all white people are racist, you're ideological, you're radical.
Wow.
You have censorship of the kinds of ideas and analytics that could come about. And that's because, whereas King said, look, all white people are racist, because this, we're talking about a global phenomenon of white superiority, a global phenomenon of capitalism. Today, to make that kind of argument puts you in a camp that people construct as being anti-Martin Luther King, radical, anti-peace, and ideological, and extremely dangerous. So what you're doing is you're divesting black people not only of the language, but the very authors that have historically made these kinds of arguments in face of black liberation.
Wow, that's so powerful. I had Dr. Jacqueline Battalora on there, sociologist, and the creation and invention of white people as a matter of law, when it was written into law, this new designation of humanity called white. What I've tried to do over the years with the family is to let them know that there can't be white and right at the same time. It's not possible. There is no right or good white person, because the thing that was developed based on genocide, oppression, and taking out all anything that is the other. So you can't have both worlds, the best of both worlds. No, it's a contradiction. Absolutely. And so I'll close with you, Dr. Smith, on this, and that is, do you believe that in order for us to survive their birth dearth and to continue to move forward as a people, that do we need to start thinking like, acting like those people in the Jewish faith in terms of looking at our current situation as a Holocaust and saying never again? You know, what level of thinking do we need to begin individually and collectively to move ourselves up and out as a people and to reclaim the land that we built? Because now, you know, I've had all of the experts on who have already shown that we've been here over 160,000 years. So we are the original Africans and then morphed into the Native American. So we've always been here. And then some of us, of course, obviously were brought over here, but this is an African land. What do we need to start doing to start becoming cohesive individually and collectively so that we can have this inoculation from racial battle fatigue?
Well, one thing I think we have to do is we have to be true to thyself. We have to understand the plight that we are in. We have to understand the circumstances, the all of the structures that are targeted against Black people. We have to really understand those and recognize that they do exist. That's one thing. Now, in relationship with the Jews, I don't think we necessarily have to look at their Holocaust. We have a Ma'afa, and we have to recognize that Ma'afa. So I think there's a lot of work that has been done again. If we look at Marimba Ani's work,
Yoruba, yes.
And we start to put these things that used to be in place in our communities from the early 1900s all the way through the 60s, where groups were getting together to hear people like Okuri, to read a book or read an article and say, what does this mean for our life? And then we start to operationalize our own self-defense, our own support of our own communities to build back Black economy once again, stop working for others. And I will add an extension to what Dr. Curry said, two extensions. One was this whole thing about Woodson. Remember, Woodson also said that a person educated at Harvard, who comes to the Black community to teach could be just as deadly as a white person teaching Black students. All right, so we have to be very careful about who we allow in our community to talk and to speak for us, and that everybody's not there and put there to support us. Now, in saying that, if there is a so-called leader that comes from one of these institutions of higher education, I'm gonna have a raised eyebrow. I think we, revolution is going to come from our community, right? And it should. Now, there is a place for critical thinkers like a Curry or a Chester Pierce or a Robert Staples or a Smith or whatever that can help in having conversations, and we can be part of thought groups on what are the best practices. But I just don't have a trust for Black politicians and highly educated Black folks that, like Curry said, that they're going to be working in the best interest of Black people in general. Now, I say that recognizing that there are some that are in these institutions and are doing great works. But my trust still is within the Black community.
Wow. Beautiful. Beautiful. Well said, Doc. Well said. Gentlemen. Wow, thank you. So we got to become segregationists, ladies and gentlemen. We got to get our act together. We got to get together so we can get our act together. And we can't do it in assimilation. So that being said, gentlemen, thank you. We have now proven that the two of you do exist separately. And congratulations on the second book, Another White Man's Burden, Josiah Royce's Quest for a Philosophy of White Racial Empire. You can get that, of course, on Amazon. It is an academic book, but we need to take an academic dive. And we've got some great self-help books in the Black community, but we also need to start reading the books from our academes And so, and taking a deeper dive and a critical look at their work. So I'm highly recommending this book, and I'm going to go ahead. Now, why is the book on hardcover? Don't nobody make a hardcover book nowadays, Dr. Curry.
Actually, I talked to the editor about that. It'll be
I didn't even hardcover. I'm like, what is that? Yeah,
but you know, they got the Kindle download available, and the paperback will be coming within a year.
Okay, my brother. I appreciate both of you. Thank you. Stick around with me in the green room as we sign off. We got the six-second delay. Family, you know what to do. Like, love, share, ring that bell so that you can subscribe and you can get notifications when we have the next Philippe Matthews show. And I appreciate all of you. Love all of you. I'm out here fighting the fight, doing the work, and trying to get the information to you as quickly and efficaciously as possible. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Hotep family.